How are we doing? Can we give a round of applause to the band? They're awesome. A lot of familiar faces in here. So how are we doing tonight? Just Colby, that's it? Only person? Hi, okay, we're back. Yeah, welcome back. So for those of you that don't know me, my name is Heather. And I'm an intern here at Life Church for Student Ministries, exploring the opportunity to figure out if vocational ministry is something I want to do for the rest of my life. I kind of like teenagers. You guys are kind of cool. And it's just really exciting for me to come here every Wednesday and every Sunday across the street at the Mix and just get to know each and every one of you in some really cool ways. And for those of you that I don't know, I would love to get to know. So I'm so thankful that you guys all showed up tonight. We got a really great message in store. We're doing a hard topic called More Elephants, which for those of you that don't know the pun, it's the big elephant in the room. When I was doing these slides, you guys will see them as they go through. These made me smile. Elephants are kind of cool. So say that? What was that? So for those of you that are just joining us, like I said, we're currently in a new series called More Elephants, where we are addressing the elephant in the room and talking about topics that make most of us feel real uncomfortable. So last week, Steve talked to us about why do bad things happen. He took us way back to the Garden of Eden, where we got to meet God's fallen angel, and he disguised himself as a serpent and convinced Eve that if she ate from the tree of knowledge, she could think and be like God. Adam followed suit, and so you have the fall of mankind. Thanks, guys. We can thank them when we go to heaven. So we figured out last week where the brokenness and suffering in us stems from and why we have that disconnect from God. The good news with that is that if we turn our suffering over to him daily and choose to follow his son, Jesus Christ, our walk with him will still have challenges, but it will become bearable. So this week I get to talk about the topic that hits way, way, way too close to home for me. Self-medication. I just need you guys to know something, that all of these things I'm going to talk about tonight are things that I struggled with tremendously and still have to be really intentional about being sure I don't continue to do these things. I was a destructive self-medicator. So by a show of hands, I kind of want to ask, how many people know what self-medication actually means? All right, it's a good portion of you guys. So for those of you that don't know, self-medication is a human behavior in which an individual uses a substance, drug, alcohol, or any external worldly influence to self-administer treatment to an illness and or feeling. So basically what this means is I am not okay on the inside, so I am going to try and become okay with something from the outside. I'm going to say that again. I am not okay with something on the inside, so I try to be okay with something, anything from the outside. That could be relationships, video games, social media, TV, Netflix, drugs, alcohol. The list goes on. We'll go more into that a little bit later. So I want you guys to ponder a few questions right now. When your parents are fighting, what do you do? Do you lock yourself in your room, put some headphones in, try to escape the world for a little bit? Maybe you're one of those people who like to dive into their fantasy books and just kind of escape reality that way and pretend to be the characters that you're reading about. When you feel rejected by your friends, what do? Do you sulk at home, maybe binge watch Netflix and eat some Ben and Jerry's? Or pizza, I heard pizza over here. When everyone else is coupled up around you, where do you turn? Are you watching Nicholas Sparks movies and pretending that you're one of the characters? Have a relationship? So we all self-medicate in some way, shape, or form. For me, you guys, personally, I did everything to escape my reality. In high school, I played sports. I was voted most athletic in high school, and I wanted to hang out with the boys and be like the boys and have attention from the boys. But it never really worked out in my favor. None of the boys that I liked actually liked me. So I was doing all of these things and trying to do things that I knew that they would like and willing to do anything to be liked, which was hanging out at parties and being the first person to take a drink, to do drugs, to have sex, and that's just being real honest. And it led me down some pretty intense, scary paths, trying to numb my pain, trying to fit in and stand out in the crowd. So I want you to think about what feelings you're having and what actions that you're taking with those feelings that you're having. So I've listed some ways that we self-medicate on the screen. I only have time to really dive into a few of them, and I believe that they're the most intense ones and the ones that I have struggled with tremendously. So I can relate to all of these things. So the first one, you guys do not know a world without technology. Some of the adults in here do, but the teenagers, you guys don't know what it's like to live in a world without the internet and access to information. And first off, technology is not a bad thing. The access that we have to information and the ability to share it to the world is incredible. But just like most things, we become obsessed with them. And we place those things as idols in our lives above God. And one of the biggest parts of technology is social media. How many of you guys have apps on your phone? Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat. Yep, that's my big one we're doing right here. Well, first off, before overexposing ourselves to social media can make us become obsessed with knowing what is going on in other people's lives, and we miss out on experiencing the joy that God has uniquely designed for our lives. We feel more confident hiding behind a computer screen. Some of you have even went to the extent of making fake profiles to say mean things and express your opinions. Some of you have even been catfished or catfished somebody. And if you don't know what that means, we can talk about that later. The big social media app that I want to talk about right now is Snapchat. I won't lie. I mean, I love some of the filters. They make me laugh, let's be real. You get to like change your voice and look silly. And it is fun. Let's be honest. The problem with Snapchat is, and some of you guys are gonna feel this because it's you. You become so obsessed with your streaks. Some of you have like 50 plus days of streaks with people. And I have seen that when you lose those streaks, your emotions go haywire. I mean, it legitimately like fuels you. That's kind of a interesting thing to get upset about. I've even seen a couple students before we left for camp ask their sibling to make sure that they keep that streak intact. It's pretty extreme to keep something like that going. My question to you is, are you putting your relationship with God before Snapchat? The next thing that we're going to talk about is, and there's some 6th and 7th graders and even some middle schoolers and high schoolers that don't want to talk about this, but it's sex. I don't want you to tune me out because you don't think it's relevant to you right now. We live in a sexualized culture. It is all around us all the time. And we are Some of us are watching it, and some of us are actually having it. And it's outside of marriage. And you guys are still young and developing into your bodies. And God created marriage, created sex for marriage to be an intimate and safe and secure place to go to with your husband or your wife. And just from my own personal experience, this topic has been coming up quite a bit. We talked about it at the mix. We've talked about it here. And it's something that we need to really understand and not lose sight of. Because we're constantly tempted and we're surrounded by it. Research had shown that porn and technology actually rewires our brain and changes our brain chemistry, and it's not in a good way. A lot of men and women see one another as objects instead of brothers and sisters in Christ, and we treat each other poorly because of that. We use and move on to the next, and we get what we think we need to fill a God-sized hole in our heart. I know a lot of you experience peer pressure in some really intense ways. I've had personal conversations with a few of you, and you do not have to do anything that you don't feel is right, and that you don't want to do in order to fit in, or to think to hang out with the cool people, or to stand out. Let me tell you something from my experience of turning my life over to Christ is when I started hanging out in those same environments that I was hanging out and I wasn't doing those things anymore, I made more of an impression than I did when I was actually partaking in the stuff. So when you feel those feelings of not like you're not blending in or you don't belong, you were made to stand out. God has something uniquely designed for each of you, and you're not supposed to fit in. You're supposed to do things differently. You're supposed to guard your heart. You're supposed to guard your mind, what you listen to, what you read, because this world is filled with things that are not of God. The world's way is trying to trap you and hold you down and make you blend in, but you are made to stand out and leave an impression on people. The last one I'm going to talk about is drugs and alcohol. You guys, this is one of my biggest weaknesses. I spent so many years trying to get high. Trying to numb my pain, trying to escape adulting. And what I realized is you can only get so high before you drop back down, because all the illegal drugs and the pharmaceutical drugs that you're abusing, they take you to this temporary place where you think that you're confident and strong and you can own the room and be whoever you want to be. And guess what happens when that drug wears off? You are left with you down here. You get to go, you go home with yourself and you live with yourself every single day. The only person that you should be, like, I'm losing it right now. Whew. I'm going to take a deep breath. For the teenagers in here, if you're under 21, you shouldn't be drinking anyways, first and foremost. Let's start with, let's just lay that out there. And the illegal drugs, if you guys want to talk about spending time in jail or having a record, I would definitely love to have a face-to-face conversation with you about that. It follows you, it haunts you, it keeps you from getting jobs. So if you choose to dabble in illegal drugs, just be prepared to pay the consequences with jail. It's a real thing. Pharmaceutical drugs, if they're not prescribed to you, you don't get to do them. So what you can take from all this is whatever you have to justify, defend, make excuses for, or keep a secret is what you are choosing to self-medicate with. I want to pause with that. Look at that screen and really think about the areas in your life that you are defending, that you are making excuses for, that you're keeping a secret from the world around you or the people that you love the most. So one of the many reasons why I fell in love with the Bible is that the stories are filled with real people living in this world, and they were faced with a lot of the same temptations that we are, and they did their best each day to place God first in their lives. It gave me hope when I first was introduced to Christ that if people like them could be saved and used for good, then someone as messed up and broken and damaged as me could be used too. Noah was a drunk. Rahab was a prostitute. Elijah was suicidal. Jonah ran from God. Martha was a worrier. Moses stuttered. David was a cheater. Sarah was impatient. And the Apostle Paul was not perfect. He murdered, he harassed, he persecuted Christians in the early church. But he became an extremely useful tool in God's hands, teaching, growing, inspiring, and encouraging. He went on to write much of the New Testament and continues to be a blessing to believers even today. If you want to read more about Paul himself, he's one of my favorite characters. You can check out the book of Acts. It's not what we're going to dive into tonight. But I want to make this clear. Although it's common that a lot of the characters in the Bible had to stumble to get where they're at today, God doesn't want us to be victims of self-medication. You do not have to jack up your life to do good things for God. I've personally had conversations with a couple of you that think that if you don't mess up, then your testimony is not going to be as great as someone who has messed up. Let me just say this. People like me who have damaged themselves and have to deal with memories that you can't erase and relationships that can never be fixed, we look at people who are pure and innocent and have chosen to steer away from certain parts of this world, and we admire it. We want that, and we'll never be able to get it back. In some regards, Jesus does save us, and he gives us the grace, but those memories are still with us, and it's a daily fight to keep moving in the right direction. So we're going to dive into God's truth, because he always has a way to guide us through our struggles. The first thing is he tells us to beware of false gods. In 1 John 5:21, he says, "Dear children, keep away from anything that might take God's place in your hearts." The Hebrews identified your heart as being the source where everything flows from. The things that you love are stored there. The things that you sometimes place before your relationship with God are there. Just like our main verse here, Matthew 6:21, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." You gotta guard your heart and beware of what you're putting there. And just remember that the things of this world will never fill God's place in your heart. God designed us for a relationship with him, and he placed the desire in us to rely on him. Do you guys realize that God is desperately waiting for us to ask for help? In Matthew 11:28 through 30, Jesus says to us, "Come to me, all who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light." It's super comforting to know that we have a place in the midst of all the brokenness and suffering in this world. We have a place to go to find rest and to just breathe and relax. There's not very much like that that really overwhelming peace. So after we've let God help us with our burdens, all the ways that we self-medicate with, we have to suit up for battle. Every single day, we have to watch our backs because there is evil in this world. So in Ephesians 6 through 13 through 18, therefore put on every piece of God's armor so you will be able to resist the enemy in the time of evil. Then after the battle, you'll be standing firm. Stand your ground, putting on the belt of truth and the body armor of God's righteousness. For shoes, put on the peace that comes from the good news so that you will be fully prepared. In addition to all these things, hold up the shield of faith to stop the fiery arrows of the devil. Put on the salvation as your helmet and take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times and on every occasion. Stay alert and be persistent in your prayers for all believers everywhere. I wish that they had this blown up like 1,000 times more because it's so important. If we legitimately every morning stood in the mirror and did this, we put on our shoes of peace and we like held up our shield of faith. Or if someone like peer pressured us, we're like, no, I got my faith. You imagine how ridiculous that would look, but like you would leave an impression. It would work. All right, so how do we do this? How do we stand firm in our faith and what God has called us to do and stay away from the evil things in this world? And how do we get better at not placing even the small things that we do? Books are not a bad thing. Video games are not bad either. Steve Kerr will affirm that. But if you have to realize we cannot place it above our relationship with God. If we're spending hours on our video games or scrolling through our newsfeed or our social media before we have our time with the Lord in the mornings, something's missing. So the first thing that we can do is we can know our triggers. Pay attention to how you deal with stress, sadness, fear, worry, and anxiety. The second thing, know your trigger and press the pause button. Take a time out. This is one of the biggest things I've learned this year is when I don't know and I'm feeling overwhelmed, I put up a big T and say, I need to take a time out and take it to the Lord. Think twice before you do something, before you watch something, hear something. Does what I am doing make me a better person? And would God be proud? So after we know our triggers, after we learn to press the pause button, we need to replace it with something healthy. Make a plan. How are you going to implement a healthier alternative to your struggles? Is it designated prayer time, a Bible study, meditation? Fasting's a really good one. Searching for music that doesn't degrade the opposite sex. Reading books that are going to challenge my faith and make me a better person. So we know our trigger. We're going to press the pause button, replace it with something healthy, and the last thing is we're not going to do it alone. We are all on the same team going after the same dream. And everyone that self-medicates a lot of the time does it in isolation. And even when you're doing it in a crowd, when you're self-medicating in a crowd, you still feel alone. You guys, your small group leaders, I know you guys love to think we just like show up on Wednesdays just because, but we kind of like you guys. And we are here to encourage you and be a part of your lives. I know that there's some of you that feel like you're a burden to us, and that you're like inconveniencing us if you ask us a question or ask for advice or ask to hang out. But we absolutely love being here and walking this life with you. And we're here to give you hope when all of yours is gone. Because I know it's tough for you guys. I mean, I heard recently that at your guys' one of the high school's homecomings, 40 people were suspended for having drugs and alcohol at the dance. And it doesn't surprise me because it's so in your guys' face now, but it saddens me because that's what you're turned into to have a good time or what you think is fun. God created you guys for so much more than just fitting in, like I said earlier, so be okay with that. Thanks for letting me be vulnerable up here. It's not about the details to my testimony that make it great. It's about the grace. It took me a long time after I met Christ to truly surrender my life over to him. I wanted to hold on to having one foot in the world's way and one foot in God's way. And every day was a battle because I knew what I was supposed to do. But when I finally fully surrendered on February 7th, 2016, and became sober from narcotics, you guys, the blessings have been endless since then. And it's not easy. Thank you, Sydney. It's not easy, but man, it is so worth it. I promise you guys, it is worth it. Every single day is a battle, but when you suit up and you're ready to take it on, it is so worth it. You meet incredible people. And who knows, some of you guys may be standing up here doing the same thing and sharing your testimony and changing lives and bringing people to know the Lord. We all have specific gifts that we were given, and we have to own them and move forward. So I'm going to close this in prayer. Dear God, your word tells me that I can't heal the wounds of my heart with the things of this world. Help me. Parts of my life or all of my life are out of control right now. I now know that I can't fix myself. Reveal to me the ways that I try to fill the hole in my heart that only you fit into. Today, I want to turn my life over to you. I ask you to be my Lord and Savior. I ask you to help me think less about myself and my own will and more about you and your will for my life. I want to be better for you. Help me to think twice before I listen or watch something I shouldn't. Before I speak, before I talk negatively to myself or to others. Rescue me in my moments of weakness, when peer pressure is around me and I feel overwhelmed. I want to every day try to become the best possible version of myself for you. And I want to make your son, Jesus Christ, famous in the world around me. Lead me where you need me. I love you. Amen. So if you guys did make a commitment tonight, or you feel like God's calling you to reconnect your faith, we are here to talk to you and pray with you. Myself, Steve, and Liz, while everyone else is in small group, we'd love to chat with you. So let's stand and worship.